is Rebekah, and I am here to talk about my trip to Scandinavia that I took back in 2018. So I went on a little tour of Scandinavia, and my first stop was Bergen, Norway. What was interesting about Bergen was when you came out of the airport, they have a giant sign essentially welcoming you to Bergen on the side of this cliff face, and it says Bergen. And then after it, it has a question mark. That's just kind of how it is. No one really knows why there's a question mark after Bergen. It just is. And that's the sign that welcomes you. So I kind of thought that was a fun and unique way to start my trip. Bergen, Norway was really interesting because we stayed kind of in an older part of town. And there are mostly wooden buildings. And these wooden buildings have been there forever. And they have started to list. So as you're walking down a street, you can see the buildings are like tilting towards you, which seems a little unsafe, but they seem totally cool with it. After just kind of walking around the town, we actually went to a couple specific museums. The first place we went was the Edvard Grieg Museum. That is the composer who did the Hall of the Mountain King. It's a fairly well-known tune. You probably would recognize it if you heard it. So his museum is in his old villa, which was built in 1885, and he and his wife lived there the last 22 summers of his life. And he composed a lot of songs there. They had a lovely time, and he's actually buried there, he and his wife. Our next stop was the Fantoff Stave Church. This is an old church built out of wood and tar. They covered like all the walls and such in tar to protect it. And this was really cool because it is a very, very old church. It was originally built in 1150. And in the 19th century, a lot of these old stave churches were threatened by demolition. So a man named Frederick Georg Gade actually bought the church and he moved it in pieces to what is now Fantoff, which is in Bergen. So he moved it piece by piece in 1883 and assembled it in Bergen. And then in 1992, the church was burned down. So he went to all this effort to move it piece by piece, and then it was burned down. Originally, they thought it was a lightning strike or some sort of electrical failure that caused the church to burn down. But later on, they realized it was actually the first in a string of church burnings by early members of the Norwegian black metal scene. So they lost a lot of really cool historical buildings to these church burnings. But they rebuilt the church. They rebuilt it and it was finished in 1997. So it still looks about the same as it would have before it caught fire. They used a lot of the same building techniques. It's still covered in tar. You don't want to touch it. It's very sticky. And what's cool about these particular types of churches is they contain elements of like Christian history and Viking history. So if you look at them, it's this kind of weird mix. After Bergen, we took a cruise along the fjord and went up the Flam Railway. So the Flam Railway is unique because it is one of the world's steepest train rides built on normal tracks. And close to 80% of its tracks run through a rise of 55 degrees, or 55%. So it is a very, very steep railway. You go in and out of the mountain. It is about 20 kilometers long. So the train ride takes you up from the high mountains down to the fjord or vice versa. And you really get to enjoy the scenery. You get to appreciate the beautiful mountains, the snow, the waterfalls, and eventually you end up in Flam. I didn't enjoy it as much as I could have because it was also incredibly, incredibly hot. And there's not really air conditioning in Scandinavia. This is one of the hottest summers they'd ever had. And there was no AC anywhere. So you're riding along the train, just like absolutely sweating to death. But the scenery was still incredible and it was still really pretty. After Bergen, we went to Oslo, Norway, and we got to see the Viking Ship Museum. This was one of my favorite stops along the trip because Vikings, I think they're pretty cool. So in this museum is the world's best preserved Viking ships and finds from different Viking tombs around the Oslo Fjord. So most of these ships were ocean-going vessels before they were hauled onto land and they were used to bury their wealthy owners. So in a lot of these burial mounds, the archaeologists unearthed skeletons, really unique and intricate wood carvings, and a whole bunch of different artifacts from the age of the Vikings. So there are three different ships there. There's the Osberg, which was very detailed and decorated, and it was equipped with a whole bunch of burial gifts for the two women who were on board. There's the Gokstad, which was a fast ship built for sea voyages. And the man buried in that ship suffered cutting blows to both legs, so he definitely died in battle and was buried with honors as such. And then we have the Tun, which was built from oak around 910 AD and had room for 24 rowers. So it had a really, really strong mast and didn't really have a lot of cargo space. So they're pretty sure that it was a warship. So we toured the Viking Ship Museum, got to see these ships and see some of the items that were contained in the ships that were used in the Viking burial rites. And after that stop, we went to the Oslo Opera House. This is a really cool, like, architectural building because you actually can walk on the roof. The way the building is built, you kind of go up these different ramps to the top level, which is the roof of the opera house. And there are gorgeous views. You can see the harbor and just the whole kind of layout of the town from this opera house roof, including in the harbor, there's a floating sculpture called She Lies. And it kind of looks like an iceberg and it floats just in the harbor. It is tethered, I think, to the harbor, but it's allowed to kind of float on the tides and move around with the water, which was kind of unique and different. We also walked up to the Royal Palace, didn't go in, just walked up and saw it, and walked over to the Nobel Peace Center, which opened in 2005 and is where they award the Nobel Peace Prize in Oslo, Norway. After that, we went to Frogner Park, which is the largest park in central Oslo and kind of a very popular rec area. Inside the park is the Vigeland Sculpture Park, which is one of Oslo's most popular attractions. It is unique, to say the least. It was created by Gustav Vigeland, and he persuaded the city of Oslo to build him his house and studio, and in return, he would donate all of his works to the city in the future. So this man was planning ahead. He's like, okay, you build me this house and the studio, and one day I will give you all of my work. And he did. And that's where we get the Vigeland Sculpture Park. He was originally just commissioned by the city to make a fountain, but instead of doing just a fountain, he did this entire sculpture park area. It has over 200 sculptures, and he was completely in charge of its design and the architectural outline. So he controlled all of it. It is the largest sculpture park by a single artist in the entire world. And most of the sculptures are cast in bronze, granite, and iron, and they represent the cycle of human life and all of its emotions. So as you're walking through the park, you'll see lots of sculptures of human beings in different stages of life, from infancy to old age. And one of the sculptures that is particularly popular is a sculpture of a little boy throwing a temper tantrum. And you can tell based on where the statue has kind of been rubbed clean, which parts of it people consider lucky. So different parts of the statue get touched by different tourists for luck. We also toured the National Museum, where we saw a painting, The Scream, by Edvard Munch. I'm not much of an art person, so I was like, okay, that's cool, and then I left. From there, we went to Denmark, which was really great. We basically boarded almost a mini cruise ship, and it just took us to Denmark overnight. So you boarded, you ate dinner, you went to bed, and you woke up in Denmark. It was perfect. So we stopped in Copenhagen, which is the site of the Little Mermaid statue. Growing up, The Little Mermaid was one of my all-time favorite Disney movies, so this was really exciting to me to see the statue that was inspired by the original tale. It is one of Copenhagen's most iconic tourist attractions. It was inspired by the Hans Christian Andersen fairy tale, and it was unveiled August 23rd, 1913. It was a gift from a Danish brewer to the city of Copenhagen. And it has kind of quite the story in its own right. So the brewer, Carl Jacobsen, had fallen in love with the character of the Little Mermaid after watching a ballet performance based on the fairy tale at the Royal Danish Theater in Copenhagen. And he was just so captivated by the whole story that he commissioned this sculpture for the city. And the sculpture itself was inspired by the ballerina, Ellen Price, who danced the lead role. But she refused to model for the statue because she would have to model nude, and she was not comfortable with that. So the sculptor's wife modeled for it instead. And so she is kind of the inspiration that you see for the Little Mermaid statue. The Little Mermaid statue has not had a nice life. She has been vandalized many, many times. She's lost her head twice. She's had her arm sawn off, and she's had paint poured all over her. But each time, she is rescued, restored, and the city keeps her in her place in the Copenhagen Harbor. So she's had a rough life, but she continues to persevere. Also in Copenhagen, we saw the Tivoli Gardens, which is an amusement park area, really beautiful kind of nature area. Walked around that a little bit, didn't pay to go inside, but got to enjoy it from the outside. There's also a lot of government buildings with really interesting spires. The architecture here, they have a lot of just really, really intricate spires on the tops of their buildings. There's one that is, I think there are four dragons with their tails all intertwined going up. There's also one with a bunch of crowns, the symbol of Copenhagen, Denmark. So each of the buildings has their own unique spire, and it's really cool to see them even from kind of street level. We went to Frederiksberg Castle, which was built by King Christian IV in the early decades of the 17th century. And it is the largest Renaissance castle in the Nordic region. And his aim with building this castle was to show off basically that he was a very powerful European monarch. He was kind of making his claim that, like, I'm here, I'm powerful, don't mess with me. Since 1878, the castle has housed the Museum of Natural History, which presents 500 years of Danish history with a collection of portraits, paintings, furniture, and art. The castle also has a chapel connected to it, which is fairly unique. It retains its original decoration because even though in 1859 a fire destroyed most of the castle, the chapel itself was left pretty much unscathed. So you can tour the chapel and still see all of the original art and the mosaics and such along the wall, which are really impressive. I have several pictures of the different mosaics. After Frederiksberg Castle, we went to Kronborg Castle, which is also known as Hamlet's Castle. It was the inspiration for Shakespeare and the creation of Hamlet's Castle. So for 400 years, this castle was the headquarters for the collection of sound dues. Basically, you had to pay to enter the sound. Kronborg was legendary in the 1500s because it had a lot of guns. So it looked pretty menacing. You had lots of guns pointing at the ships that were entering the sound. And so no one dared to sail past without paying the king the proper sound dues. So they used this castle to really kind of fill the king's coffers, make the money. And Frederick II adorned the castle with a lot of spires, sandstone, and copper roofs. He spruced it up and made it look really cool. And Kronborg became one of the most beautiful castles from the Renaissance period. Like many, many other castles, though, this one was also ravaged by fire. In 1629, the flames devoured most of the castle's furniture, paintings, and its roof. And kind of from that day on, the castle went downhill. The Swedish king, Carl Gustaf, occupied and plundered Kronborg in 1658. And for the next 300 years, Kronborg was only used as a fortress and barracks for the Danish army. So it had its heyday. After the fire, everything kind of went downhill for it. So after Denmark, we moved on to Sweden, Stockholm, Sweden. And this was part of the trip that I was looking forward to the most because my family is Swedish. And my father had actually been to Stockholm, Sweden, oh goodness, probably like 40 some years ago. So it was really interesting. I was traveling with him to see how things had changed and kind of experience it a little bit through his eyes. So Stockholm, Sweden, our first stop was City Hall. It's another one of those buildings with a really cool spire on it. It has a 106-meter tower, which is covered with three crowns, which is the Swedish national coat of arms. And Stockholm City Hall is one of Sweden's most famous buildings and one of the most visited tourist attractions. It is also where the banquet for the Nobel Prize is held every 10th of December in Stockholm City. They give out four different Nobel Prizes, physics, chemistry, medicine, and literature, because the Nobel Peace Prize is awarded in Oslo. One of the most famous parts of this building is the Blue Hall, and it's actually used for the Nobel Peace Banquet. And when you walk into it and you hear it's called the Blue Hall, you're not really sure why, because there's nothing blue in it. It was originally intended to be blue, but when the architect saw the beautiful red bricks and decided like, oh, I don't want to paint these. It looks so pretty just the way it is. He decided not to paint the bricks blue and to keep it the way it was. So it's called the Blue Hall, but there's nothing blue in it. City Hall is also a very popular venue for weddings. Lots and lots of people like to be married there. So they do ceremonies on Saturdays between noon and 6. They're held in the Oval Room and they only last about 5 minutes. So if you want a nice long wedding, this is not the place for you. It's gonna get in, get married, get out, because there's a bunch of people behind you waiting to do the exact same thing. Also in the City Hall is a gorgeous mosaic room. It's called the Golden Hall. And this hall definitely lives up to its name. It's covered with more than 18 million glass and gold mosaic pieces and is the work of artist Eleanor Forsyth. I mean, you walk into this hall and it is gold. It is glittering, it is ornate, it is quite spectacular. It's done using a Byzantine-inspired style, and the mosaics depict the portraits of historical figures and events in Swedish history. So the main mosaic is the Queen of Lake Mälaren. It's on the northern wall, and that particular image depicts Stockholm being honored by the entire world. So if you look at the mosaic, you can see emblems of different countries around the world. There's a little Statue of Liberty for the US, the Eiffel Tower for Paris, and basically the whole world is coming together to pay homage to Stockholm. After the city hall, I went to the Vasa Museum, and this was probably one of my absolute favorite stops on the trip. This is another place that my father had visited many years before. And when he visited, the Vasa wasn't actually put together as a ship. It was just a museum where you could see their preservation of the ship kind of ongoing and them trying to put it together. But when I went, the ship is now completely together and you can tour the museum and really get a feel for the history of this really ornate warship. So kind of to summarize, when Gustav Adolf ascended to the throne in 1611, he inherited three different wars. He was at war with Russia, Denmark, and Poland. So he was kind of going into a rough time. Gustav Adolf was actually at war 18 of the 21 years of his reign. So he spent most of his time as king at war. So he commissioned these warships. In 1625, he signed a contract to build four new ships, one of which was the Vasa. And it was designed to be the most powerful warship in the Baltic, possibly in the entire world. They were putting everything into this ship. So it took 2 years to kind of build. They launched it, and then they spent even more time outfitting it. So it takes 2 years to build, and then they spend the summer doing all the rigging, finishing the hull, making it spectacular. So when this ship is finished, it is 69 meters long and more than 15 meters tall from the keel to the top of the main mast. The ship weighs over 1,200 tons. Once it is outfitted with all of its sails, it has 64 cannons, 120 tons of ballast, and hundreds of sculptures. They skimped on nothing on this ship. You know, lots of cannons, very fancy, and it weighs a lot, which is gonna come back to bite it. So another year passes, and in 1628, the captain who is supervising construction is concerned. He has 30 men run back and forth across the deck to show that the ship isn't sit steady. It's rolling back and forth with all of this movement. But they are under a lot of pressure from the king. They need to get this boat, you know, ready to go. They spent too much time and too much money on it. So it's ordered to sail anyway. So August 10th, 1828, the Vasa has her maiden voyage. She sails 1,300 meters and no further. She's still within sight of the shipyard where she was constructed and built. She heels to port, water comes in, down she goes. Is widely considered to be one of the shortest maiden voyages ever. Several people are killed in her sinking, but most people were able to escape and swim to shore. And this catastrophe is viewed by everyone. All of Stockholm's inhabitants are there. A bunch of foreign ambassadors are there. Everyone sees the ship go down. So somebody has to be blamed. The Royal Council writes and they tell the king what happened. They launch an inquest and everyone is saying, it's not my fault. I didn't do this, you know. You can't blame me. The ship's officers say, no. The builders say that they built the ship according to the design that the king approved, so it's not their fault. And the experts look at it and they say the ship just didn't have enough hull to carry everything they put on top of it, all of those statues, all of those cannons. The ship just wasn't built to carry that much weight. So they decide to blame the ship's designer, Henrik Hybertsen, for the poor proportioning of the vessel. But as a stroke of luck, depending on how you look at it, Master Henrik is dead. He's actually been dead for more than a year, so he can't defend himself against these claims of blame. And he also cannot be punished because he's not here. So the Vasa stays at the bottom of the sea until 1956. So it's down there for a long time. Different people tried to find it over the years. They were interested in mining the wood to build furniture. Some people just wanted to blow the wreck up. But it took until 1956, and a man named Anders Franzen locates the wreck, and he sends divers down to inspect the wrecked Vasa. So the divers go down, they take a look at it, and they realize this ship is still in amazing condition. It's essentially intact. The foremast is still standing because the water is too cold and the water's too fresh for shipworms, which would usually have destroyed a ship like this. And centuries and centuries of raw sewage has been dumped into this harbor, which created sort of a dead zone at the bottom of the harbor where not even bacteria could live. So essentially the water was just too disgusting for bacteria to go into the ship and eat away at it. So the divers spend some time trying to prepare the ship to be lifted. The city entertains some different ideas on how to bring the Vasa back up. I think one citizen proposed filling the ship with ping pong balls and seeing if that would work. But they decided to go with a tried and true method. They dug tunnels, ran some, I don't think they were cables, but they ran something under the ship to lift it back up. So they lift it up and they move it up really, really slowly. They moved it in 18 different stages, kind of just to prepare the ship, move it slowly so that they didn't do any more damage to it. So April 24th, 1961, the ship sees daylight. The Vasa is finally pulled to the surface and she's emptied from all the water by three enormous pumps. They work on her for 10 days, continuously inspecting her hull, plugging any leaks, and trying to preserve the ship to the best of their ability. Now, this is a warship from the 17th century. This ship is old, and they really, really, really want to preserve it and keep it as intact as possible. So they know that when waterlogged wood dries out, it cracks, and this is something they don't want to see happen. So to prevent the Vasa from being completely destroyed after they put in all this work to lift her out of the harbor, they begin replacing the water in the wood with polyethylene glycol. Any objects that are loose on the ship are placed in large bathtubs, and the hull of the ship is sprayed around the clock with the help of 500 different nozzles and a super elaborate kind of pumping and filtering system. And they did this treatment on the Vasa and the ship's wood until 1979. So that is 17 years. And even after that, they're not done. The ship still has a long way to go. The wood still needs to dry out because they've been spraying it for 17 years to avoid the cracking. And so they build this very specific museum to house her where they can climate control the humidity. So for the next 10 years, they are very, very gradually lowering the humidity. And that's actually still going on. The ship is still continuing to dry out, and this will continue over the next few decades. But altogether, since the Vasa was salvaged in 1961, over 40 million people have been to see her, which is pretty impressive. I mean, 40 million people have been to see the ship, and she truly is a work of art. If you are ever, ever near the Vasa Museum, definitely go. It's amazing to see, you know, the workmanship from way back then and the efforts that have gone into preserving her so that you can see her today. After the Vasa Museum, we stopped by the Royal Palace, which is one of the largest palaces in Europe. It's a combination royal residence, workplace, and historical monument that's open year-round to visitors. So we just kind of walked around, enjoyed the beautiful architecture. It's done in a Baroque style, and it has more than 600 rooms divided between 11 different floors. So this thing is big. Then, after touring the Royal Palace, we took a ferry, and I'm going to say this wrong, I know I am, to Djurgården, Stockholm, also known as Museum Island. I can say that. This is an island in Stockholm that houses most of the museums. It's where the Vasa Museum was located, it's where the Nordic Museum is, and it is where the ABBA Museum is. If you're familiar with Mamma Mia, some of their music. I didn't go in. I kind of regret it now because I do enjoy ABBA's music, but I got to see the outside, which was pretty cool. After kind of walking around touring some of the museums, we took a ferry to Drottningholm Palace. And Drottningholm Palace is Sweden's best preserved royal palace, which was constructed in the 17th century. It is a permanent residence of the royal family and one of Stockholm's three World Heritage Sites. The palace has been the permanent residence of the present royal family since 1981, and the rooms in the southern part of the palace are reserved for members of the royal family, so you don't tour that part of it, you tour the rest of it. All right, and after finishing up in Stockholm, Sweden, we took a ship to Helsinki, Finland. So this was the last stop in the Scandinavian leg of my journey. In Helsinki, we visited the, it's another word I'm gonna have trouble saying, Tempelakio, rock church. This particular church is unique because it is embedded directly into the bedrock. So typically when you think of churches, especially Western ones, you think of them being built on the surface with tall spires. This one was blasted directly into the rocks. You actually like go down into it. It has a very unique roof and unique architecture because literally they blasted into the stone to make this church. So when it rains, the water seeps down the walls. They actually have special drains to pull it away. And the church hall itself is covered with this dome lined with copper. It kind of looks like this giant floating disc. And it's supported along the rock walls by reinforced concrete beams. So it's nothing like I'd ever seen before. It was almost like this cavern, but instead of being like dark and claustrophobic, it's really filled with light because of the way they designed the roof. This church was met with a lot of negativity originally. The public wasn't sure about it. They wanted a traditional cathedral. They thought the rock church wouldn't be Christian enough, and it would look too much like a defense bunker. They kind of, this was still, you know, after the wars and everything, they were like, this is just gonna be like a bomb shelter. But when the church was actually completed and everyone was able to see it, it really is a work of art and it is gorgeous and the public came around to it. We also visited the Sibelius Monument, which is a monument designed to embody the spirit of Sibelius's music, but it's really weird looking. A lot of critics were like, what is this? Because it looks like just kind of a bunch of pipes hanging there. So they decided to add a bust of Sibelius to kind of pull it all together and be like, yes, this is the man. This is the monument designed to embody his music. Put the two together. It was interesting, but kind of weird. After that, we stopped in Senate Square, which is unique in the fact that, you know, you're in Finland, and you go to this square and it's a very Russian feel because in 1809, Finland was annexed by the Russian Empire. Until that point in time, Finland had been an integral part of the Swedish realm for more than 600 years, But in 1812, Alexander decided to make Helsinki the capital of Finland. And he declared it, it wasn't like the country of Finland, he called it a Grand Duchy, the Grand Duchy of Finland, and Helsinki was going to be its capital. So he spent a lot of time making this grand ornate Senate Square. There's a statue to him in the middle of it, of course. And he spent a lot of time and money kind of outfitting this brand new capital in a very grand manner. So that was my last stop in Finland. From there, I went on to Russia, which I'm not going to talk about today. But I hope you really enjoy kind of this brief taste of Scandinavia and my trip there. I had an amazing time. They are beautiful countries, and if you get the chance, you should certainly go. Thank you.